The latest version of the Nik Collection 6 is out, and I'm reviewing a beta version of the software today. I'll be walking you through the latest changes since version 5, as well as demonstrating some of the Nik Collection applications by editing my photos. First in the list of changes for the Nik Collection 6 is to the control points. Control points help us select and adjust areas of an image. In the Nik Collection, we have the option of applying global adjustments that affect the entire image, or local adjustments that only affect parts of the image by applying our adjustments with a control point. For example, if I want to select and enhance the rocks on this ridge, I can add a control point to select the area. What's happening is that the software is sampling the pixels below the center of the control point. It then selects the other pixels that have a similar color and tone that are inside the area of the control point. After adding a control point, it appears in the selective adjustments list. We can also rename the control point to make it more obvious what they're used for. To see what the control point is selecting, we can click the mask button to toggle the mask view on and off. Now we can see the areas selected by this control point shown in white. But what makes the control points easy to use is that they're interactive, so when we move them around, the mask changes. This gives you a lot of control over what is and isn't being affected by your adjustments. In the previous version of the Nik Collection, the luminance and chrominance sliders were added. These allow us to make changes to the sensitivity of the control point to tone and color to further refine our selections. And as I've been explaining this, you'll probably notice that the area selected by this control point extends beyond its edges. This is designed to help blend your adjustments with the rest of the image. The only problem is that you may not want it to do that, and you may require it to be more accurate. And this is where the new diffusion slider in the Nik Collection 6 can give us additional control over this spread of the control point. By default, it's set to 100%, but when we reduce it, we restrict the feathering around the edge of the control point. This can help us create more precise selections while still blending our adjustments. If I turn off the mask view and increase the contrast and structure, you can see that it's only affecting the rocks in the area of the selection. And whilst we're talking about control points, I want to show you something else that I'm very pleased about. We now have the return of the control arm. When I click this small icon above the local adjustment list, I can display my adjustment controls on the control point. Now, this used to be in old versions of the Nik Collection, but it was removed when DxO moved to the new design for the interface. I'm pleased to say that DxO appears to have listened to user feedback and that the controls are back. Better still is that they're optional, so we can turn them off and on as we need to. With the controls available on the control point, I can now adjust the image without having to go back to the controls in the side panel. This makes such a difference to how easy it is to edit my images. I also like that DxO has found a way to include the newer controls for selective tones, and that we can adjust the control point sensitivity here using the luminance, chrominance, and diffusion sliders. But there's something else that I've discovered which wasn't mentioned in the briefing I attended. Let me add a control point to the foreground to show you. To see what's being selected, I can turn the mask view on in the selective adjustment list. But I don't want to keep moving over to the right side of the interface to toggle the mask on and off. Now, in older versions of the Nik Collection, some of the applications used a shortcut key. If you held down the command key or a control key on a PC, as you positioned or resized the control point, you would see the mask view until you released the mouse button. This was removed from these applications when they were migrated to this new interface. I don't know if it's new to the Nik Collection 6 or an earlier release, but I'm delighted to see this back. This is a great feature that makes working with control points so much easier. Now let's switch images, because there's another new feature that I want to demonstrate. Photos like this one can be a pain to edit using control points. If I want to select the foreground, I need to use multiple control points. It's then difficult to get the adjustments even across the entire area. Now we have a new control line feature, which some of you may already know from the DxO PhotoLab software. You'll find the control line icon in the selective adjustments section of the Nik applications. After clicking the icon, click and drag on the image to draw the control line. If I turn on the mask view, you can see what's being selected by the control line. This has two lines with a graduated area between them to help blend the adjustments. Below the bottom line, everything is being selected, and above the top line, nothing is selected. We then have a sample point which we can position anywhere on the image. As I move this, you can see that the mask area is changing to reflect the sample point. We also have the luminance and chrominance sliders to control the sensitivity of this selection. If I hide the mask and apply an adjustment, you can see that it's applied evenly across the area. It's also nice to see that the shortcut of holding down my command key works with the control line as well. Now I want to show you another new feature that you might overlook. Let's add a control point to the center of this image, and I'll turn on the mask view so you can see that what's selected. By clicking the inverse icon here, I can invert the selection. And this works with control lines as well as control points. Let's apply this change now, because there are some other new features that I want to show you. If you already use the Nik Collection with Photoshop, you probably know that you can apply most of the applications as a smart filter. The advantage of this is that it saves your settings as part of the smart object layer. Then it's possible to reopen and change your adjustments. But the changes I've just applied were made directly to the image layer. This is what we call a destructive edit, because we then can't go back into the application to change the adjustments. To be honest, I make this mistake a lot when using the Nik Collection, because I forget to create a layer and convert it to use smart filters first. Fortunately, there are now two ways around this problem. The first is to delete the image that I just adjusted and then use the last edits option in the Nik Collection palette. When the application reopens, it automatically applies the last set of edits I saved. That's useful, but it becomes more powerful in the Nik Collection 6. If we look down to the bottom left corner of the interface, we see the new last edits panel. Here you'll find the last 15 edits that you applied with this Nik application. We can then browse these and click on any of them to apply them to the current image. The only problem now is that I've still forgotten to create a new layer and convert it for smart filters. In the past, this meant having to close the application and return to Photoshop to start again. But in the Nik Collection 6, we can convert the current layer for smart filters from within the Nik application. All we need to do is tick the option at the bottom. Then when we apply our adjustments and return to Photoshop, the changes are applied as a smart filter. Okay, let's go to look at another image, because there's some more new features that I want to show you, starting with Nik Color Effects. As well as having all the features that we've been talking about, Nik Color Effects now gets a new HSL filter. This allows us to target different colors in the image. For example, if I pick the oranges in this image, we can then change it to a different color using the hue slider. I can also use the HSL filter to adjust the saturation and, of course, the lightness of this color. Another new feature is the inclusion of a search bar for presets. For example, if I want to apply the soft landscape preset to this image, I can enter soft in the search bar. This then lists the presets which have the word soft in the title, which we can then click to select. I can imagine this being very useful for people who've got a lot of custom presets, although you will need to follow some kind of naming convention to help you find the ones you want. Let's switch now to Nik Define, which has been migrated to the new style of user interface. This allows you to take advantage of all the new control line and control point features we've been discussing. There are now only two applications that have the old style interface, which are Nik HDR Effects and Nik Sharpener Pro. Whilst these aren't included in this release, they are scheduled for later this summer, and I understand this will be a free update for existing Nik Collection 6 owners. Now let's look at the Nik Perspective application, which allows us to correct lens and perspective distortion. If I click the auto button, it applies the lens correction, but we also have a manual option for lenses without modules. This image also has a severe case of converging verticals, because I was using a 14mm wide-angle lens with the camera tilted upwards. Whilst I could correct this manually, the auto button seems to do a great job of it. But supposing we only want to change part of the image, like increasing the space between this arch and the top of the gate, that's where the new reshape tool comes in. I can use this with one of four predefined grids, or I can create a custom grid of my own by selecting the number of rows and columns. When we choose one of these, it overlays a grid of nodes onto the image. Let's magnify the area of the door so I can show you how this works. I'll select two of these nodes by clicking and dragging out a region with my mouse. I can then drag one of the selected nodes down and it changes the other node by the same amount. Notice how this allows me to warp parts of the image without affecting other areas. Now, because I didn't have all of the nodes correctly selected, the top of this gate isn't straight. All that I need to do is select and drag other nodes. Then when the image looks right, I can apply the changes to the grid. If I turn off the reshape adjustment, you can see the difference this creates. Most people would never notice that this image was altered. I should also mention that when I installed the software, the installation process had changed slightly. Affinity Photo users will be pleased to know that the installer now recognizes and includes Affinity Photo in the list of compatible applications. This means that you don't need to add it manually. But do remember, if you're installing the trial version of this software, it will replace older copies of the Nik Collection. Be sure that you still have access to your old installation files before doing this. In terms of cost, a new full license for the Nik Collection 6 is $149 and the same in euros, or in pounds it's $135. And if you already have the Nik Collection 4 or 5, you can take advantage of the upgrade price of $79 or euros, or £69. So how best to summarise these changes? Well, if you were hoping to see lots of new filters and AI technology, this release will disappoint you. Instead, I see this release as being aimed at photographers and photo editors who want precision and a high degree of control over their editing. Now, I use the Nik Collection daily, and I've spent a lot of time using the version 6 beta software. What I've noticed about it is how the changes that I've talked about combine to improve your workflow. It reminds me of when I reviewed the DXO Pure Raw 3 software earlier this year. It's only when I thought about going back to the Nik Collection 5 that I realised how much I'll miss them. And if you missed my review of DXO Pure Raw 3, you may want to watch that next. Otherwise, thanks for watching today. I hope you've enjoyed this, and I'll see you soon for another video.